Earlier this year, I made a video about whether or not you should change your answers during exams if you're unsure on them. Now, the prevailing wisdom has always been to go with your gut, but the research we looked at presented this as what they call the first instinct fallacy and showed that more often than not, changing an answer you're unsure of is more often the better choice. Now, the amazing thing about science is that at any point in time, new data can come and make you wrong. And that is exactly what has happened to me because now my initial recommendation for you is wrong. And due to that wonderful quality of science, I now have a new and improved method to suggest to you. And since I use an ambiguous title for this video, I'm just going to lay it straight out for you so I don't waste your time. Next time you're taking an exam, whether it's your final exams if you're watching this video near its publish date or any exam in the future, right after you answer each question, you should rate your confidence in that answer using a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being super unconfident, I'm not really sure, and 5 being, I definitely know the answer to this question. Now, this technique takes advantage of something called metacognition, which is essentially thinking about thinking. It's our ability to analyze our own beliefs and decisions. To make an analogy, it illustrates how the brain is a lens that sees its own flaws. One of the core aspects of metacognition is our ability to judge our confidence in our knowledge. We can feel uncertain. That is, we know when we do not know. I first started learning about metacognition a couple of months ago when I talked to a guy named Justin Couchman, who's a professor of psychology at Albright College in Pennsylvania. And Couchman's first forays into the study of metacognition took the form of research on rhesus monkeys. No, not rhesus monkeys, but yeah, you know. In a study he helped conduct called, and bear with me because this is a mouthful, The Highs and Lows of Theoretical Interpretation in Animal Metacognition Research, he and two other psychology professors set out to see if animals have the same metacognitive capabilities that we have. In their study, the monkeys were given questions of varying levels of difficulty, and they had to either give an answer or indicate that they didn't know the answer. And Couchman and the other professors were surprised to find out that the monkeys were able to accurately judge their confidence and indicate when they didn't know. They were able to look inside their brains and analyze their own thinking, much like we do. With the results of this study in hand, Couchman started thinking about the metacognitive abilities of his own students, who were often surprised that the grades on their exams were often much higher or lower than they initially predicted. And it turns out that there is a reason for this. The problem with metacognition is that it isn't perfect. I use the analogy of a lens that sees its own flaws for a reason. Our brains are subject to all sorts of bugs, cognitive biases, heuristics, flawed modes of thinking. Like, to quote the AI researcher Eliezer Yudkowsky, the brain is a flawed lens through which to see reality. This is true of both mouse brains and human brains, but a human brain is a flawed lens that can understand its own flaws, its systematic errors, its biases, and apply second-order corrections to them. One of the biggest flaws is that our memories are notoriously unreliable, and as a result, our metacognitive capabilities decay as we try to use them to analyze thoughts that we had further and further in the past. So to learn more about this, Couchman decided to conduct another study, this time on humans rather than monkeys, and they set up two different tests. In the first test, they had students take a real-life multiple-choice exam, but after each question, they asked them to rate their confidence on a binary scale, either writing G or K for guess or known. Additionally, they asked the participants to indicate whether or not they had revised each answer after giving an initial answer, and for this first test, they found that revisions were more often than not correct, especially for the answers that were marked guess rather than known. After this first test, they decided to conduct a second test, and the only difference here was that instead of using a binary rating system, guess or known, they decided to have the students rate their confidence on each question using a 1 to 5 scale, 1 being super unconfident, and 5 being almost certain. And the results here were interesting because in this case, the initial answers were more often correct than the revisions. Now, these results would seem contradictory, and that would be the case if there were only one rule of thumb. Either stick with your initial answer, you know, go with your gut, or as the previous research showed, revisions are better. But using confidence tracking, there's no longer just one rule of thumb. When you assign a confidence score to each question in the moment that you answer it, you're utilizing your brain's metacognitive abilities at their most accurate point, giving your brain a more sensitive tool with which to make a decision. So to wrap up here, there were two key findings to that study. Number one, beliefs formed about the exams after the exams were over were very, very poor predictors of actual performance. And this shouldn't come as a surprise. I remember myself going into many exams as a student, super confident that I was going to do awesome, and then I got a bunch of questions wrong. Or on the other hand, being really worried that I wasn't ready and then just absolutely acing it. And I'm sure you've had these experiences as well. But more importantly, metacognitive tracking in the moment was a much more accurate predictor of success and gave the students a more accurate tool for judging whether or not they should make a revision to an answer. So there you have it. When you go into your next final exam or any exam in the future, try assigning a confidence score next to each answer as you answer that question. Doing so will help you to more intelligently make revisions and hopefully get better grades. Now, if you're curious and you'd like to know more about the research that went into this video, I did an hour-long podcast with Justin Couchman where we went more in depth in his study, and you can click the card right now, wherever it is or down below, to listen to it. And I've also linked to all the relevant studies in the blog post for this video. That's all I've got for you this week. So if you're watching this and you've got a final coming up pretty soon, best of luck on it. And hopefully this technique will help you out. And in next week's video, we'll be talking about an often requested topic, how to make a study schedule for finals. So look forward to that. And as always, thanks for watching. Hey guys, thanks so much for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, giving it a like can definitely help this channel out. And also, if you want to get more study tips every single week, you can hit that big red subscribe button right there. In addition, I also wrote a book on how to get better grades, and I made it free, so if you'd like a copy of it, click the picture right there. If you want to read the summary and get links to all those studies, click the orange button to go to the blog post. And if you missed last week's video, we talked about 15 writing apps that can help you become a better writer. Lastly, if you want to connect, I'm Tom Frankly on Instagram and Twitter, or you can leave a comment down below.